This is Frank de Boer. I'm now chairing our second invited presentation talk, which will be given by Eelco Visser, who is widely known for his excellent work on programming environments. And the excellence of this work is also clearly recognized by his employer, the Technical University of Delft, who appointed him as the Antoni van Leeuwenhoek Professor since 2013. And let me quote from his website that the aim of such professor positions is to promote young academics who produce excellent work to the position of professor at an early stage so that they can develop their academic careers to the fullest possible extent. And I think this is clearly what Eelco Visser so far has realized. So I'm happy again to give the floor to Eelco Visser.
Thank you, Frank. And so before I start the talk, I would invite you to actually, at least some of you, to share your video. So I've been doing a lot of Zoom in the last months, and it is nice if you're talking not just to your screen, but actually see your audience and see when they're falling asleep or have puzzled looks in their face, so I can actually answer the any questions that come up. And also, Frank before said that you should ask questions in the chat, and I should open the chat so I can see those questions. But I would actually also welcome if you would just interrupt me and ask a question with voice. That would make the talk a bit more interactive. We're not a huge group, so I think that is quite feasible to do. So please interrupt me if something is unclear or you have some whatever questions you have. All right. Yes, so I'm going to talk, I'm Eelco Visser, professor at TU Delft, and I'm going to talk about multipurpose syntax definition with SDF3. I was delighted that Frank asked me to give a keynote at 7. For one reason is that it was going to be at CWI, and well, that's close where I live, so I wouldn't have to travel very far. I mean, some people may remember that in the past you had to travel to conferences. But the other reason is that I actually did work at CWI. Well, actually, I worked at University of Amsterdam in the mid-90s, and where I did my PhD work. And I would like, it would be nice to talk about, sort of to reflect what I've been doing since I worked there in that time. So by now, it's 25 years later, I work at TU Delft. And so then I was a young, enthusiastic researcher with lots of ideas. And well, nothing has changed much. I'm still a young, enthusiastic researcher with lots of ideas and glasses, but that's just for looking better. And well, face mask, but I haven't done, yeah. There's other reasons for that. And well, but it's still a long time ago, right? So 25 years ago, we had lots of paper. And so at home, I didn't have much of a computer. And well, the gadget you see there on my desk at the University of Amsterdam was called a workstation. But that it wouldn't pass as a phone these days, I would think, computational power-wise. Right, and these days we have fantastic machinery that we can work on, and also in many other respects, this is a long time ago. Yet, when I think about research, I still remember what goes on there, and the fact that we are writing papers helps a lot with it, with making that record. And in 1995, I presented my work on SDF2 at the ASF plus SDF 95 workshop on generating tools from algebraic specifications. And so that was the first sort of design paper of SDF2. And what I thought about doing. So Frank invited me to submit a paper, to contribute a paper to the proceedings. And I took the opportunity to write a paper on, we worked on SDF2 then, and now it's SDF3. So we advanced one digit. In this paper, I'm describing the work we've done on SDF since then. So it's sort of a survey paper of all the research that has been going on. And it's not as if I haven't done anything else in the 25 years in between. I mean, I've worked on things like program transformation, built a workbench, a web programming language, built a theory of name resolution with scope graphs, done work on build systems, done work on automating soundness proofs for programming languages, etc. All along this work, I've been kept work on syntax definition and parsing, and so that's what I want to talk about today. So let me give you a short history of SDF before I dive deeper into and give you an overview of what it is all about. So SDF is not my invention. So it was first developed. So the first paper about SDF was in 1989 by Hering, Hendricks, Clint, and Rakers. And Paul Clint was my advisor at the University of Amsterdam. And they described there the syntax definition formalism SDF. It had some cool features. So it integrated lexical and context-free syntax. If you know, at the time we had Yuck, which Lex and Yuck, which had separate formalisms for defining lexical syntax and context-free syntax. And also the context, the syntax definition sort of doubled as algebraic signatures. Unlike other formalisms like Yuck at the time, SDF supported generalized parsing. So you could support a whole class of context-free grabbers. And that really made it much more powerful, as we hadn't had to deal with things like parse table conflicts. And it supported lazy, incremental, and modular scanner and parser generation. So it really gave you a nice interactive environment to work with. And it did support modules, so you didn't have to define your syntax definition as one monolithic thing, but you could divide it into separate modules. And this was one component of the ASAP SDF meta environment, what we would now call a language workbench. So when I started my PhD in 93, I started working on syntax, and the comments of Jan Rekers at the time was, why are you bothering about syntax? That's a dumb deal research-wise. Maybe there's a bit of engineering to be done, but 25 years later, we are still working on all kinds of syntax-related research. So what did I do? So can you hear me, by the way? My microphone is acting weird. Yes? All right. So what did I do? I made generalized LR parsing scannerless so that it takes individual characters as tokens, and that required that you would do disambiguation. I added disambiguation filters, so I did a study on disambiguation filters in general, but in particular in SDF we included disambiguation using associativity and priority, and based on shallow conflicts, those were integrated in during parser generation. And so that made it fairly efficient. I designed a sort of a family of syntax definition formalism, so a high level language that was then normalized to a low level core language. And later, I sort of struggled in my thesis with, what is the motivation for having this formalism? But later we did all kinds of work on language composition, where because of the features of SDF2, it was very easy to compose the syntax of various languages to create composed languages. And ultimately, that this was the basis for the syntax definition in the SpoofX language workbench, a language workbench based on the Eclipse platform, where you, well, a programming environment for making programming languages in Eclipse. And after that, we've started work on sort of the next generation of SDF, SDF 3, and which I will talk about today. And so what we add to SDF, so we take all the features from the previous generation, but we add multi-purpose syntax definition. So we generate many more tools from a single syntax definition. And we added some features. So templates is a feature for formatting instructions. So you can instruct how a pretty printer should work. We have, so there were some problems with the with associativity and priority disambiguation in SDF2. And we have solved those issues, and also we are working on a semantics for associativity and priority, and proving that it is correct. And we have added layout support for layout sensitive languages, so that we can support languages like Python and Haskell. All right. So this SDF is actually used in practice. It's not just a sort of a research artifact. We're using it in education, in compiler construction. Students are at the moment writing syntax definitions for ShocoPy, a language with layout sensitive syntax developed at Berkeley. We're using it in research to design all kinds of DSLs, meta DSLs, and other kinds of DSLs. And several industrial collaborators are using SDF to define languages. So while I did a lot of work as a PhD student on SDF2, on SDF3, there's many contributors to this work. So Leonard Katz and Martje de Jonge worked on error recovery. Toby Vollotbrecht and Leonard Katz worked on templates. Layout constraints were added by Sebastian Erdweg. Eduardo added layout declarations, a higher level of layout constraints. And well, in general, I need to say now that SDF3 was really made possible by Eduardo. So he joined me as a PhD student in 2014. And before that, we had some PhD students who worked on their on syntax sort of on the side. But Eduardo really was dedicated to working on syntax, and he did a lot of work on the sort of implementation and maturization of SDF3 and making progress with in various topics. So we worked on disambiguation, on syntactic completion, and in general on the implementation. And currently, Jasper Denkers and Martin Seim, who's also here, are working on a new implementation of the parser. All right, so what I want to do in this talk is give some highlights of features of SDF3 that I think are interesting. And so I'll talk about phrase structure, formatting templates, declarative disambiguation, and layout constraints. But the general takeaway from this talk should be that we want languages with multi-purpose interpretation. We want high-level languages, declarative languages that you can use as inputs for many different kinds of tools, right? So the traditional interpretation of parsing of a compiler such as Yacc is, well, it's for parsing. But in fact, there are many other kinds of tools that we want from a syntax definition, and likewise for other kinds of language aspects, but also for other kinds of DSLs. So what I want you to think about is how can we make our languages higher level and more declarative so that we can have more kinds of interpretations for them. All right, but let's dive in and look at concrete aspects of syntax definition. So let's start with phrase structure. So what is syntax? well, if you look at this fragment, right, I mean, people think about, we think about syntax as, well, it's a bunch of characters and I should be in the right order, right? A program has parentheses and keywords and arrows and operators, and we should mix them in the right order. But really, you know, so you think of syntax as strings, as sentences that are well formed. But really, as a programmer, what you do see when you look at the piece of syntax is the underlying structure of that program, right? In the program here, we're seeing a function application of a function literal with a parameter x and a body x plus 3 applied to a variable y. And the function literal is between the parentheses, but that's for grouping, right? So really what trained programmers see when they look at programs is the underlying structure, I posit. And so in SDF, what you do as a language designer, as a language engineer, is you think primarily in the first place of what is the structure of programs, right? So when you're writing syntax in SDF, you write productions like in any, but you focus on the structure rather than sort of other details that we'll talk about later. Right, so here in these productions, we see that, so what is a production like? It has a non-terminal, so the kind of phrase that we're describing. It has a body, so an addition is an expression and an operator plus and another expression. And it has a constructor, and that constructor is indicates the, it's the name of the construct, right? And we can use that to name these things. Well, that's an addition, but we can also use it as the name of the structure in the tree. Right, here we have an addition. And so really the tree structure I'm showing here has a lot of details that actually are sort of irrelevant when we're thinking about the structure of programs. And right, there are these parentheses and there's these kind of artifacts. And so really we're rather thinking in abstract syntax, where we're saying, well, where we eliminating the irrelevant details such as of keywords and operators. And we just reduce it to, well, the names of nodes, which are named by these constructors, and the sorts of their children, right? And here we see that, well, we have an application of a function literal with an argument and a body, etc. So syntax is primarily structure. And well, of course, you can look at that structure as tree pictures. But well, this tree picture is isomorphic to a term, right? So this is a first order term and written in a different way. Here we have a different way to describe the structure of this program. All right, so with syntax, we describe programs. You can hear me indeed, right? Because the light on my microphone is blinking, and all right. Okay, so then, and to describe the structure of those trees, we then see that these syntax definitions are really isomorphic to algebraic specifications. Right, so each production in the syntax definition corresponds to a declaration of a of an algebraic signature, right? So here we have a constructor int that takes an int literal and produces an expression. And here we have an add that takes two expressions and produces an expression. And really this is sort of another way to look at, to interpret the syntax definition is just as an algebraic signature. And so indeed we do generate these such signatures automatically from syntax definitions for a range of different languages. But you don't even really need to look at these signatures to understand what they are, because you can see it here, right? So here we have an addition that takes two expressions as parameters and produces an expression. So in SDF2, SDF1 and SDF2, this was a bit more apparent because we would write the non-terminal that is produced on the right-hand side of the production. So you would write x plus x, arrow x, and that would make it sort of more obvious that you had this correspondence to algebraic signatures. But it turned out that notation was too confusing for people sort of familiar with BNF notation. And so therefore we moved to this more sort of traditional notation for grammars. All right, so So what I would like is that language designers, language engineers think of programs as structures primarily, and not as how do I make a parser, right? I want you to think, well, what is the algebraic structure of your language? And then you should think about that in this way, right? So yield is a function that takes a parse tree and produces a string. So basically it takes all the leaves of the tree and concatenates them. And that's an easy operation, right? So if you have a tree, you can just do the flatten of that tree, and then you get the corresponding sentence. Parse is the inverse, right? So it takes a sentence, a string, and turns it into a parse tree. And that is, many people are intimidated by parsing. And the idea of the design of SDF is that you shouldn't have to think about, well, how does this parser work? But does it guarantee this equation, right? So if I take the yield of a tree and then parse it, do I get back the same tree? And if that just works, then you have a syntax definition, then you have a parser. I mean, as long as the tool guarantees that it produces that. All right. So the first sort of motto of SDF is language designers should focus on the structure of programs rather than sort of mucking around with strings. Of course, if you are making a programming environment, then so one aspect is mapping strings to trees, but you may also want to go the other way around, right? So if you're making a compiler or a code generator for right, or a transpiler, then you're producing programs, and what you should produce when you produce programs is those program structures rather than the sort of the strings. You shouldn't do string generation, you should do structure generation. But then you also want to pretty print those structures to make textual programs again that we can read. And so formatting is an important aspect of language engineering. And what we used to do with SDF2 is we would have a pretty printer, pretty print table generator that would make a table that's mapped constructors to their notation. But it was very tedious because you wanted to update those to make pretty printers. And so every time you change the grammar, you had to update the pretty print table, and that was very tedious. And so what we added in SDF3 is the notion of formatting templates, which looks like this. So in formatting templates quotes the entire right-hand side of a production, right? So here we see expression is expression with a plus operator, but the whole thing is between quotes, between angle brackets, and so the plus here is literal text, but within that template we anti-quote the expression on terminal, right? So here we're saying, well, same thing, we have an expression plus expression. So this is isomorphic to what we saw before. But what we can do now is add layout hints. So we can make two-dimensional, we can make these production two-dimensional, right? So here we say for the let production, it's not just let and some bindings and in and x, but there's actually some layout here, some white space that we use to lay out this pattern. And so here we see that let is followed by a bunch of bindings, which are separated by double new lines. And then there's a new line, and then we have an in on the new line, which is indented a bit, and then follows the body of the let. And so what we do when we parse a text, we get a structure somehow, as we just learned. But with these formatting templates, we can also do the inverse mapping, and so map structures to text again, and we don't have to sort of write a separate pretty printer to do this, but we can use the layout hints in the program to get this formatting. So another way to...
May I interrupt?
Yes.
Yeah, just a question. I mean, I'm not an expert in this thing, but you were talking about parsing and generating trees from syntax. from sequences of symbols. I was just wondering, across my mind, to what extent the notion of a tree plays a role, because, for example, you use infix notation. If I would use prefix notation, I would get a more clearer grasp on its structure when I pass the thing from left to right than, for example, in infix notation. So to what extent is this use of infix notation requires this explicit representation of finding out the structure by constructing a tree? But
you're saying plus is an infix operator?
Yeah.
I mean, well, if you would prefer that to be a prefix operator, you can. I mean, you can write. I mean, I could write the plus operator in front of the two expressions,
or
behind if you want a postfix operator. But I mean,
but then you would generate if I would represent a string purely or all the operators in terms of a prefix notation, I would in a kind of way have a more immediate grasp of its structure. For example, I could easily compute it the meaning of an expression than when I have its infix notation, for example.
Well, I mean, if you look at the structure here, right? I mean, here you get your prefix notation.
Yeah.
Right. In the structure, I have at is a prefix operator which takes two arguments, the two arguments of the addition. So there we abstract over the fact that plus is infix. I mean, all the operators here are prefix operators, are terms, algebraic terms, and so there we abstract from the fact that plus is an infix operator, let is a prefix operator.
Yeah.
But in programming languages, people follow notation from mathematics, say, where plus is used as an infix operator, right? So when you write these things, you want to think you want to use that common. The notation that's common in the domain that you're programming.
Yeah, and that's why you would need to transform them. Yeah.
Right.
Okay.
Yeah. Right. So here we use the notation of the domain, and here we have a generic notation for the structure, for representing structure.
Yeah.
Right. And this notation is really reused between languages. Right. It's always the same. It's constructor applied to a list of children.
Yeah. Thank you.
Other questions? Right. So we can see now that we can see syntax productions as describing structure. We can see them as describing a mapping from text to that structure. But we can also see them as a mapping from structure to text by interpreting these productions as formatting instructions. So here's another, so now we can refine that previous equation as follows, right? So where we take a tree, an abstract syntax tree now, we format it, then we get a string. If we parse that string, and then we get a parse tree. And if we implode that string, that is what we call the mapping from parse trees to abstract syntax tree, then we should get the same abstract syntax tree. Right, so this is the specification that we're thinking about. We define how we map tree structure to text, and we expect the parser to do the right thing. Another interpretation that we can place on that structure is to consider incompleteness. Right? So when we are developing programs, we write text, and we'll expect that the parser produces the underlying structure. But sometimes it can be useful to have a more sort of kind of structure editor approach to programming these programs. And we have done that by automatically extending languages with incompleteness. So for each non-terminal, we create a placeholder symbol that you can use in programs, right? For example, here, $x is a placeholder for expressions. And then we can complete that in the IDE by doing, I don't know, what is it? Option space. And then we get a list of proposals for that are valid at that point in the program to replace that placeholder. And And we can, and we do that completely automatically based again on the syntax definition, right? So looking at all the productions for a for a non-terminal, we can produce the list of extensions, the list of extension proposal or completion proposals for that placeholder. And we can do that so that we can guarantee soundness, right? So only complete programs so that you get syntactically correct proposals. And also to guarantee correctness, completeness, in the sense that you actually can reach all programs in this way. So using these completions, you can create any structures. And again, these templates are useful because right here you see the formatting of the programming I'm going to get. It's followed just the template of the let binding in the grammar. All right, so notation, well, language designers should think about that, about structure of programs, and then about how does that structure map to text? What is the notation used in programs? All right, so that's sort of the basis of syntax definition in SDF. Then we have some things to deal with. For example, here's a possible grammar, right? So we have a little grammar for arithmetic expressions with infix operators for minus, addition, and multiplication. And this is a fine structure, right? If you're thinking about the structure of such expressions, this works fine. They're all binary operators that take two expressions as arguments. But if you're looking at it from the point of view of parsing, you see that there is a problem. Right, I mean, so here's a sentence, A plus B times C minus D, that has multiple structures that have that sentence as their yields, right? So here we have the tree A plus B times C minus D, but right here there's other parses. And so ambiguity means that there are multiple structures, multiple parse trees for the same sentence. Well, you can solve this by rewriting this grammar to an unambiguous grammar. And if you've done, you may have done that exercise in your compiler class and writing a so-called an ETF grammar. But that is rather tedious. And so in SDF, what we do is we describe disambiguation as a separate concern by adding associativity and priority rules to the grammar, right? So here we're saying addition is left associative and multiplication has higher priority than minus and addition, and minus and addition are mutually left associative, right? And if you're following those rules, then you'll see that only one of these possible parse trees for the sentence is correct according to these disambiguation rules. It's selected according to these disambiguation rules. And this is nice. And so for language designers, you think in terms of disambiguation as a separate concern by using these rules. Now the question is, what do these rules exactly mean? How do we define that? And in SDF, we developed a notion of subtree exclusion rules. And so how does that work? Well, we have rules like these. If we have a priority definition for a production C1 that has higher priority than a production C2, then that means, right? Let's look at an example. Right? For example, multiplication has higher priority than addition. Then that means that the production with lower priority cannot occur as a child of the production with higher priority, right? And so that's a bit counterintuitive, but that's sort of you want the things with higher priority to appear under the things with lower priority. But in subtree exclusion, there are negative rules, right? We're saying things that are not allowed. So for example, multiplication as a parent of an addition is not allowed, right? So that means the other tree is allowed. All right, so it's not allowed on the left and it's not allowed on the right. And associativity is similar, but then it's only one-sided, right? So for left associativity means that a tree cannot occur on the right-hand side of a tree. For example, if left is left associative, or if addition is left associative with respect to itself, then this tree pattern is not allowed, right? So where an addition occurs to the right of an addition. And similarly, right associativity works similarly, right? Now, so these are the rules that were in my dissertation in 97. And they're nice, right? They're just three rules that explain how associativity and priority works. And we see here that it works fine for binary operators. But how about, let's first see that they work, right? So here we see that same ambiguity that we saw before. We have minus, plus, and times. We have the sentence. There's all these possible structures for that sentence. And we see now that using these rules, we can look at each of the trees and see whether they match one of these patterns, right? And here, for example, we see that, this tree matches the pattern that minus should not occur as a child of a plus, right? And here we see that minus is left associative with add, so it should not occur in this configuration, etc. Right? So we see that all of these trees, but for this one, has a conflict with one or more of these conflict patterns. And therefore, by exclusion, we exclude all the rules that match one of these patterns, and we get one tree left, and that is the result of this ambiguation. We see that this works for infix operators. Now let's look at prefix operators. For example, we have a unary minus now, and it has a higher priority than addition that would create a conflict pattern like this, right? So minus cannot occur as a parent of addition or of multiplication. And that is good because it will exclude things like this tree, and it will exclude this tree because multiplication has higher priority than addition. But it will allow this tree, where we see that minus has higher priority than addition and multiplication, and multiplication has higher priority than addition. So this tree has no conflict. So that's great. But now if we look at this example, so here we have lambda expressions, and we declare that, and lambda, right, is this structure where we say we have a lambda, so that's a sort of a keyword, then an identifier, a dot, and then an expression. So in a sense, that's a prefix operator. And here we're declaring that addition has higher priority than lambda, because if we have lambda x, x plus x, then we want that addition to be the body of the lambda. All right, so that means that we get this conflict pattern, but we also get this conflict pattern. And now if we look at actual trees, then we see that if we have the sentence A plus lambda X B plus C, well, then this is a possible tree which is rejected. This is a possible tree which is rejected because, right, this one is rejected because we have why is it rejected? Because we have a lambda as a child of an addition, right? So it matches this pattern. This tree is rejected because it matches this pattern. And we have a third tree, which is this one, which is also rejected because it matches this pattern. So in fact, it turns out that there is no trees that are allowed with these rules for priority. And that is that was a bug in SDF2, which I sort of knew about, but I didn't know how to fix. So I had an implementation that was based on these shallow conflicts, and I didn't know how to do a better job. And so this was noted by Afoza et al. in a paper in SLE 2013, where they present a safe specification of operator precedence rules based on derivations. And so that was interesting work, and they also pointed the way at a solution, which we incorporated in SDF. So what we did is we reformulated these rules as subtree exclusion rules, and as follows. So the general rule for priority was too general. So it basically said any high priority operator cannot occur as pair. Well, any lower priority operator cannot occur as child at any position, and that was a bit too liberal. And so the refined rules are as follows. So you say that if C1 has higher priority than C2, and C2 is right recursive, then it should not occur in a left recursive position as a child of C1. Right, basically. So here, this argument is a pivot, and it should not occur in that place. And similarly, if C2 is a left recursive operator, then it should not occur in the right recursive position. This means that this pattern now is a conflict pattern, right? It's still a conflict pattern because the lambda operator is right recursive, and it occurs as a left recursive child of the addition. But this is not a conflict pattern because lambda is right recursive, but it's not left recursive, and so therefore it should not occur in a right recursive position of the addition as a conflict. So basically, it rules out this rule as a conflict pattern. I see that Hans Dieter is confused. No, you're still following. Okay, good. And similar rules for associativity. And they should only work for rules that are both left and right recursive. So this is great. So now we sort of solved the problem that we had before, in the sense that now we see that this tree is still is still wrong, right, if in this sentence. But these trees are no longer rejected. So it's safe, right? It doesn't reject all the trees for a sentence. But it's now become a bit too liberal because now we have two trees that are a result, right? And that is the problem that I didn't see how to solve. So the problem is that the problem here is that the lambda is deeply nested in this branch of the addition, and therefore we cannot see that there is a conflict, right? So you could see here there is a conflict between this addition and this lambda, right? It matches this pattern, but there's this addition in between that hides it, and that's the cause of the problem. The problem, if you interpret these conflict patterns shallowly, then you get an incompleteness for low priority prefix operators, right? Because these lambdas can be arbitrarily deeply nested within the within this branch here, causing this ambiguity. This thing is a conflict pattern. But it also generates this conflict pattern, right, where it is nested in sort of the right branch of this subtree, at any depth in this right branch of this left subtree. And so, really, a set of priorities now generates an infinite set of conflict patterns that you need to interpret a grammar against. But if you have those conflict patterns, then you'll see that you will correctly note that this is now a conflict, and that this tree is the one we want, right? Where we see that we have a lambda, which is lower priority operator, embedded in a higher priority operator that is allowed, because it's a prefix operator. That's the only way we can parse this tree. But we should push these kinds of infix operators down so that they become part of the body of this lambda over here. And that took us a while to get. All right. So with that, so we get a safe and complete interpretation for priorities between all kinds of, well, infix and operators, and actually it turns out to work for mixfix operators as well. Right, the lambda really is a kind of a mixfix operator. And then the question is, well, one is a set of disambiguation rules, safe and complete for a grammar, in the sense that, so what does that mean? Let's define it in terms of the negative, right? A set of disambiguation rules is unsafe when there are no sentence or no structures without conflicts, right? So here we see that we have defined addition and minus as both left and right associative. And that means that we exclude all possible parse trees for this sentence, and we reject the sentence. A set of disambiguation rules is incomplete if we have too few disambiguation rules, right? If we leave out the rule that says that multiplication has higher priority than addition, then we also allow this rule or this tree. And so that's one of the things we've been working on. So the semantics of associativity and priority. And so we define that by means of subtree exclusion of deep tree patterns that are forbidden. We know when a set of disambiguation rules is safe. You should have at least one rule for each pair of productions. And when it's complete, that you should have it's safe when you have at most one rule for each pair of production, right? So because then you can still there is a tree without conflict, and it's complete if there's at least one rule for each pair of productions. And so if in effect you want to have a disambiguation rule for each pair of productions, and then you can guarantee the correctness of this by the language definition and the tooling. At the moment, I have my students do exercises in which they have to take such a grammar and then transform it to a grammar that is unambiguous. And that is a non-trivial exercise. And for basic grammars, that is already basic expression grammars, that is hard. If you have these low priority prefix and postfix operators, it becomes really hard. And so what this tool provides you is a sort of a way to get this right without sweating a lot. But the proof of safety and completeness is non-trivial, and you're still working on it. In the spirit of multi-purpose interpretation, we see that we can inverse disambiguation, right? So the advantage of disambiguation as a separate concern is that we have the grammar that describes the structure. We then define the disambiguation rules, which describes how to select the structure that we prefer. But another advantage is that we now can interpret these disambiguation rules to insert parentheses, right? So again, when we're going from structure to text, we throw away the parentheses because they're not relevant for the structure. But when we are formatting, we need to reintroduce them. And again, by interpreting these disambiguation rules according to the semantics I just defined, we know where it's necessary to insert parentheses. Namely, if you would leave out the parentheses, you would get a conflict in a tree, right? So in the abstract syntax tree, you can have trees with conflicts because, I mean, semantically that is fine. But if you want to map them to text, then you want to put parentheses around tree structures that would have conflicts. All right, any questions so far? All right, so then let me talk about the last topic. So we just saw we've seen how syntax is structure, how we can do disambiguation as a separate concern by defining how to select structures. Another way to select structures is made popular by languages like Python and Haskell. It's where you look at the at the layout of a program in order to decide what how a program is disambiguated. Right? If you look at this program over here, then you see, well, we have an if with an if and an else. If I would define this with disambiguation rules, typically the rule is that the else belongs to the closest if. Right? So this else, would belong to this if. But in Python, this is decided based on the layout, so the new lines in the indentation. And here you see that this if is aligned with this else, and therefore they belong together rather than these belonging together. And that makes a lot of sense, right? Because if you're looking at programs, that is how you interpret a program. I remember a programming exercise in my Pascal course in the first year where Pascal doesn't have this layout sensitive property. And a typical trick question was to sort of do the indentation wrong, and then you would have the wrong interpretation of your program. I mean, this kind of layout sensitive syntax forces you to choose, get the layout right. But then, yeah, so for a long time, SDF2 didn't support layout sensitive syntax. So Sebastian Erdweg in his thesis work worked on the notion of layout constraints in order to extend SDF with layout sensitive syntax. And the notion is based on a couple of attributes of trees, right? So you can see, if you look at this program here, you again, with your programmer's mind, you see a tree rather than a string of characters, right? And you see here that the argument of the do is a list of clauses. That is a tree structure, and you can recognize some attributes. So first is the sort of the left edge, the leftmost edge of the tree. So it's the first character. Last is the right character, or the last character. Left is the leftmost edge of the line that's not the first line. Is that the right way to describe it, Eduardo? And right is the rightmost edge of the tree, but not the last line, I suppose. Right. And then in terms of these attributes, you can define constraints, and I'll show some examples. Right, so Sebastian Erdweg defines these layout constraints, and there you use these attributes to define properties of such programs. Right, for example, here we have a do, which takes an expression list as a parameter. An expression list is either a single expression or it's an expression list followed by an expression, and an expression here is just an identifier for the sake of simplicity. And now what we're saying here is that what we want is that the elements of a list should be aligned, right? So here we see that these expressions are aligned, and actually these expressions are aligned. Here we see that this expression is aligned with that expression. And here we see that E3 is aligned with none of those expressions, and the same here. And so the constraint here is that so one here refers to the position in this production, right? So that refers to the expression list. And here we're saying that the first of the expression list and the column of that thing, right? So the we're not caring about the lines, should be the same as the column of the first of the expression. So this expression and this expression and this expression are all aligned. So we have three expressions in this list. And here we have two, we have E1, and this whole thing is an expression, and these expressions are aligned. So they're the expression list of the second do, etc. Did I say it right, Eduardo? Good. All right, so that's how you can use layout constraints to define this. Eduardo then extended layout constraints with a notion of layout declarations, where you have a bit higher level expression of these things. So basically, we want to express the same thing, namely that expression list and exp are aligned, but rather than saying that in sort of these low level things, these columns should be the same, we have this notion of a line, which says, well, these things should be aligned. And there's really sugar for these for this kinds of constraints. And you can do that for lists, right? So you want all the elements of a list. So in SDF, you have clean operators and lists with separators and so on. And aligned list says that, well, all the elements of the list should be aligned.
Can you have several rules for one thing?
So several constraints?
Yeah, in Kotlin, for instance, there are some things that you either align horizontally or vertically, but they have to be aligned. So can you have like two of these rules per one production rule?
We have a disjunction, right, Eduardo? There was a...
Yes, so you can have disjunction and conjunction operators, so and or.
You can have multiple layout constraints.
And then who decides which one which branch gets chosen when you pre-print?
So pre-printing is a bit trickier. In that case, I'm actually not sure how it would work. So there is something for single constraint like this, like a line list, the example that is there, but I'm not sure how it would work with multiple constraints.
Okay. Thank you.
No worries.
All right. So yeah, so there are other examples. I'm running out of time, but let's see, I did alignment. So offsite is a similar concept, right? So now you say, well, this construct is offsite. It means everything should be to the right. And again, you can express that using a layout constraint by saying here that the left of the expression should be greater than the first of the expression, right? So everything should occur to the right of the first line. So everything on the left edge should occur to the right of the first edge. So this thing is wrong, and this program is wrong. This is fine, and this is fine, and this is fine as well. And then we have a high-level version of that. And you can do relative offsites, right? For example, now you can say, well, you want offsites not respect to the first of the expression, but with respect to the do. And then you would allow a program like this, but exclude a program like this. And then you have indentation, which is a similar notion, right? You want the expression here to be indented with respect to the do, but you don't require it to be indented, so you can have it on the same line. But if you look at things like Python if statements, then they should be indented. And then we have a new line indent where you can say, well, this expression should be on a new line and it should be indented. And again, you can express that using a combination of layout constraints. So here we see that, again, it is about structure, right? So syntax is about structure of programs. But here we're considering layouts. How does program layouts disambiguate that structure as a separate concern? All right, I'm running out of time, but I'm also running out of talk, so that's good. So I, what I've done in this talk, I've given you a couple of features of SDF3. There's more in the paper. SDF3 is integrated in the SpoofX language workbench, which gives you a programming environment for SDF and other languages. So in SpoofX, you can edit a syntax definition and then build it. And within the same environment, you can use that the generated programming environment for your language. So you have really an interactive workflow where you can develop the syntax of your language. And you get things like, well, formatting and producing the ASTs of your program and syntax highlighting and syntax checking, etc. Out of the box from the environment. All you do is write a syntax definition. All right, so then let me wrap up. So what I've done is I've described SDF3, and in particular, we have seen that SDF3 provides a high-level declarative domain-specific language for syntax definition. So it's basically context-free grammars, but extended with a lot of goodies, such as constructors for structure, with template productions for defining layouts for 3D printing, with disambiguation rules as a separate concern, with layout constraints as a separate concern, which allows you to define all syntactic aspects of a language in one specification. And so you write this, well, declarative description of your syntax, and you get a lot of interpretations of that specification for free, right? Of course, you get a parser, but also a parser with error recovery. You get an editor with syntax highlighting. You get a formatter. You get syntactic completion. We have worked on fuzzing, so generating random programs that are syntactically correct. We do testing. We saw parentheses insertion, signature generation, etc. And it's all possible because it is high level and declarative. I must say, I mean, SDF3 is still a work in progress. I mean, it is pretty good. But even today, Eduardo and Jasper were working on. So we haven't tested layout sensitive syntax as much as other features. And also we have a bunch of different parsers, for example. So we see that feature interaction is becoming an issue because different people work on different versions and don't take all the constraints in consideration. And so there's still things to do here. This is not a finished process. But let me zoom out a bit and generalize what I've talked about. So this recipe that we apply to SDR3 can be generalized, right? So the general idea is having a high-level declarative domain-specific language, which has a declarative semantics, right? For SDF, it's a semantic of, well, is this tree well-formed with respect to the syntax? And that is an easy thing to understand, right? So you can understand that syntax or that semantics without a deep understanding of parsing. So it abstracts from implementation details. You don't, as a user, have to understand how the parser works. And you define all aspects of a language in one specification. And from that, you get then a multi-purpose interpretation, right? So many tools from a single specification. So execution, generation, fuzzing, completion, reverse engineering, right? I mean, we saw a talk about decompilation before. Can we get decompilers from the definition of compilers, for example? And so we are applying this recipe to other domains of language definition. So we're working on statics, which is a language for static semantics based on type constraints and scope graphs. We work on dynamics, which is a language for dynamic semantics definition. We work on flow spec for data flow analysis, and Stratego, which is for transformation. So this is all in the domain of language definition, but we're also working on other domains, such as web programming, data modeling, and configuration space exploration. So here's my vision for formal methods. What I see as a where we should go is to define domain-specific languages that encode the rules of a domain, right? And that have a declarative semantics, which is formally specified and easy to understand, right? So you should be able to describe or understand what a DSL program is about by understanding its declarative semantics. And users should focus on domain programs in those DSLs. And then we should have multiple interpretations, that is operational semantics of such a language, right? And I mean, basically for each of the things I've shown, these are different operational semantics of a syntax definition. And they should be sound with respect to the declarative semantics. And so currently for SDF, well, this is sort of software engineering to define these things, but ideally we shouldn't have a number of bugs that we are having if we would verify these implementations, right? So one of the topics we're working on is to define operational semantics of languages and then intrinsically verify aspects of such a semantics. So ideally, we would define an operational semantics, and from that operational semantics, automatically derive an implementation that is correct by construction, right? Rather than, well, here we have this semantics, and then map it to a whole bunch of code that that we hope implements that semantics correctly. So really, you want to define that semantics in, say, dynamics, and then get an interpreter for free. And then what we're doing is making SpoofX a language designer's workbench, but that helps you put together all these things, right? Using these high-level meta DSLs to describe your aspects of your language, and turn that into tools that are that give you an implementation for free of various aspects of your language. And hopefully that doesn't take another 25 years to complete. So thank you.
Yeah, thank you, Ilko, for this very nice overview of your work. So we have some time for some questions. Any questions? I don't see in the chat box, but we can also.
Yeah. So thank you for the overview. The question for, since you stopped on this slide, you obviously want more questions about formal methods, right? So, and given that we are at CEFM, so is there, or has this already been done? Are there some plans in connecting SpoofX as a front end with some, SMT solvers or anything in the back with Z3, with, anything at all that's sort of an external tool that comes really from the formal method domain?
Right, yes, excellent question.
If no, why?
Yes, no, so the CSX tool or DSL that I mentioned is for, stands for configuration space exploration, and that's developed in collaboration with Canon. And that is really, and there we have as backend MiniZinc, which again maps to various constraint solvers. And so there we're exploring a new kind of architecture for DSLs where we're not compiling to, bytecode, but to constraints, and then using constraint solvers to provide answers to questions. But then the DSL provides sort of a higher level abstraction for that particular domain. That allows you nicer abstractions over writing those constraints directly. So we translate to constraints, but also translate back the result that we get from constraint solving to the IDE and present that in the IDE in terms of the original specification.
Mm. Okay, thanks.
Another thing I can mention is the statics language for static semantics is has a constraint solver as backend. So basically you define static semantic constraints and scope graph constraints. And so there we use a solver as backend rather than a sort of a traditional code generation model. But in this case, we are writing the solver ourselves. So I don't know whether that counts in your book as a
sure.
Using formal methods. But. Mm-hmm.
Some other questions?
Hmm. So how about more expressive grammars, such as two-level grammars, also known as Van Wijngaarden grammars? Do you intend to support such grammars as well? So that's interesting. So in my dissertation, I did, so part one was about SDF and about these disambiguation filters. Part two was about multi-level specifications. So I first had 100 pages of specification of a multi-level specification language, which indeed, where you took signatures as signatures for type level and then any amount of levels, basically. And then I had a chapter on multi-level grammars, which took this, the same correspondence that you saw between grammars and algebraic signatures, but then to multi-levels, right? So you could define the syntax of non-terminals, basically. And then you get, types of types. I don't, Yeah, so in a sense, that is now what you would call dependently typed programming, right? So where you take the structure, you define a more richer structure of types at a higher level. So the dependently typed programming is one way to see this. I don't think that is necessarily a good approach for doing syntax. So I think it's good to have separation of concerns where you say, well, this is the context-free syntax, and then we do type checking where you may have sort of these multiple levels. But doing that, letting the parser do that, solving that problem is not, I think, a good idea, because the parsing in itself is already complicated enough, and a dependent type checker is complicated enough. I don't think you should want to mix those two.
Yes. So thank you for the answer. The reason why I ask is indeed in similar connection to dependent type theory, which is typically used for theorem provers such as Coq. And I can imagine how, for instance, the syntax definitions can help in defining notations that then can help you, for instance, in formalizing theorems and expressing proof. So indeed, that was sort of the background I had indeed with the question.
But
have you thought of this application domain really in theorem provers?
Yes, I have. The one issue there is dynamic or extensible syntax, right? That is, so where you, maybe that was what you were thinking about. In ACDA and in Coq, you can define new notation for operators sort of on the fly rather than in the grammar of the language. Indeed, I have been thinking about that, how to solve that. So the important thing there is that you need to dynamically extend the lexical syntax of your language. Basically, when you declare an operator, you need to now parse a new operator as say an infix operator or a prefix operator, and then you need to disambiguate. And basically, I think the same semantics that we're using for disambiguation we can apply there, but as a term rewrites on the term rewrite rules on the AST. But a proper answer requires a longer talk.
If I may, I have a question concerning your roots. How does your work relate to Rascal?
Right. So Rascal also derives from ASF-PossessDF, right?
Yeah.
If we were talking about syntax, right? So the main difference in syntax is that Rascal has chosen for GLL parsing over GLR parsing.
But it's more like an implementation issue. The overall functionality is more or less overlapping.
There's lots of differences in choices in various places. For example, the kind of parsing algorithm. So a GLL parsing algorithm allows you to makes it easier to propagate certain information during parsing, for example. And then there are lots of different design choices in other aspects of Rascal versus PoofX. So one important sort of design philosophy is that in Rascal, they have one language in which all aspects of language definitions are integrated. Whereas in PoofX, we have chosen to have separate languages for language definition. So we have a language for syntax definition, for static semantics, et cetera. I don't know. That is how it is. I don't know. So there's advantage and disadvantage to that.
Okay.
So the if you
time another 25 years will learn us which one will survive.
Yeah, that's right. There may be other factors involved as well that have nothing to do with the actual work, I suppose. But yeah.
Okay, thank you. Are there some other questions left? And if not, then Eelco, we thank you again for your very nice overview.